our national anthem.
What a day. Weather is just perfect. Look at that crystal blue Atlantic Ocean. The palm trees are tropical racing paradise here in Hallandale Beach, South Florida. Capped by a live shot blowing out there in the southern breeze. Good old glory on this 4th of July, 2019. We are fast and firm. We are so happy to have you with us, everybody, on a 12-race 4th of July. Ron Nicoletti, Jason Blewett alongside. Beautiful scene outside as we get ready for a Marathon Thursday.
Wind coming off the ocean, so factor that into your handicapping out of these beautiful picture of the flag.
Absolutely. And I'll tell you, that ocean breeze coming in even from the parking lot into our office felt pretty good this morning a few hours back. Now, we do have some stuff to get into right off the bat. We'll get our Thursday formality out of the way, and that includes with Old Glory, in fact, making its appearance on our What's on Tap chalkboard. I like that quite a bit. Happy 4th of July and a safe one at that from all of us here at Gulfstream Park. We've got a three-turn, 12-furlong turf marathon, and I'm looking forward to seeing what Honor Code can do as a stallion. He was a good horse, wasn't he?
He was a great horse, so we'll see how this day plays out. Love these 12-furlong races. You have your handicapping on, and I always look for the one that had success at it in the past.
Well, you've got Salute the Colonel, of course, coming out of a recent, very comparable stakes win for Joe Orsino. More on that in a second. And speaking of 12s, like the 12-race rundown, six, in fact, on the main, the other six on the turf course. We do have that lonesome carryover that begins in the seventh race, as we are indeed in a new meet, the summer meet, 12,000 plus in that jackpot 20-cent Rainbow Six. That'll start in race number seven. We get right into it, Ronnie. We are, what, 52 minutes on the clock, a little more than that, before we start the first of a dozen on this 4th of July. And why don't we get right into my early pick five? I do like the sequence, and that includes very much so the number four, my single in the fourth race, fittingly and maybe appropriately on the 4th of July. By way of Britain, by the way, a British bred named La Americana for Wesley Ward took all the money first time out. She will run against the boys. I'm hoping she can obviously run a lot better and have more staying power. Maybe she wires the field, but a good fourth race. I know you like Dexter, one of your favorites, who shows up in the first, meanwhile, who's one of three I have. A 1-4-5 spread to start this thing out, an $18 play. Dexter among the live players, to say the least, though, here in the first for trainer Ralph Nix.
Live is pretty good there. Dropping to the 20 level with blinkers added. Stalk the pace flattened out a little bit when finishing fifth at the distance. Got the current favorite Jamaican in the second spot along with Curioso in third. I thought that was the logical couple of horses in that race.
Yeah, this race to me, it's a field of six, by the way, and a $20,000 to $16,000 maiden claimer on the dirt. You've got two-thirds of this field dropping and claiming price, and I prefer, at least for my top three, horses that have not yet run for the 20K. Want to take a shot with the one lucky fortune. It's Barboza, barn I like a lot, second time out. Need not be a monster to make an impact here, dipping in for the 20 Gs. We move on to the second race and the first of six on the firm turf course today at Gulfstream Park. We'll go five with these two-year-old turf sprinting, $35,000 maiden claimers. And there's quite a bit of guesswork to be had, Ronnie. And I have a feeling, even looking at the early double will pays, our horse, the four, translates slowly. He's going to take some play in this one for David Fox.
Yeah, he's a gelding, son of Ken Tharrow's out of the Labib mare, Miss Ladonia, bred really on both sides to like the turf course. Jason, I'm sure, will expand on that. But I got a stat on David Fox. I found this interesting. Two-year-old first-time starters on the turf. I looked it up. 8 for 26. He's 31%, 46% in the money, and a 438 return of investment.
Absolutely. Good trader here. A bit of a home track, home field advantage, you will, with the four translates slowly going out for Victor LeBron and just tying a ribbon around the mare. She won six races, dirt, turf, and synthetic. Got to like the handiness and versatility with her. And four of her five siblings to date have been winners. You've got the six-fold in the family, and the number four translates slowly. Now, Biff, as a big Back to the Future guy, and I love that Arendelle. They've got McFly. They've got Hill Valley. We can add Biff to the mix. I see you've got that one rated a little higher than I do for trainer Oscar Gonzalez.
Yeah, gelded son of brethren, debuting for Arendelle, and as you mentioned, Oscar Gonzalez, Lasix. I like the fact that Jairo Rendon is going to jump aboard. And I wrote in my analysis, watch the toad action to see where the live action is going in this race.
No doubt. And early on, Biff is definitely taking some play. Think of that dopey line of his, why don't you make like a tree and get out of here? He was Biff for sure, and we've got his namesake in the second for Arendelle. Let's move on to race number three. After scratches, just a quartet, if you will, meeting the starter of this 5.5 furlong, 6250 claimer, in which I will say, Ronnie, for a four-horse field, we might get, and this is where things get interesting, the one Northern who I picked and the two Mr. Kisses look just way better than the two outside horses. The thing is, they might hook up from the gate. That's the one thing that worries me. They might just both eliminate themselves. I'm hoping dropping back down into the lower level claiming ranks with that speed. However, yeah, it's just good for the number one Northern.
Well, I've always been a friend of Mr. Kisses, who moved to the Juan Arriagada barn after the claim. Faces those open claimers. Return from the layoff, duel for the lead. Northern, sharp winner on a good track, couple of starts back. Those are the logical two in there.
Yep. All right, let's move on to the fourth, more two-year-olds, in fact, in this $65,000 made in special weight. I'm bummed, a little bummed, Churchill Downs just didn't send us the replay we had asked for more than a few days ago, back in the middle of the afternoon on Monday. I had wanted to show Leigh Americana her first start, where not only did she run into perhaps some illusory trouble there off the far turn, it looked like she was out of horse when she kind of steadied out of a tough spot. I don't think that cost her a placing by any stretch. She's also coming out of a race that are going to take her here against the boys for trainer Wesley Ward, where the speeds just melted down. I mean, the speed horses in that race, and she was on the lead, in fact, wound up running 8th, 7th, and 6th. I think that might just be a better effort than it might look at first blush. I'm going to take the filly against the boys second time out.
Yeah, I backed over for a little bit doing that. I got to sneeze. The change in the winner up here. I backed off this horse, probably the logical one. I just haven't been enamored with Wesley Ward's horses running, so I sort of backed off it a little bit and went with Montfort, who you have in second today.
Yes, no, that colt is by Carpe Diem, who's gotten off to a good start at stud. The dam herself won five races on the turf course, and there's a half-brother by Stormy Atlantic, who is a minor winner on the turf. You do have a two-race experience edge on some of the others in here, and you do have the presence of Edgar Zayas. We've also, of course, got Christian Torres riding for trainer Mark Cassie on the Bernardini first or in Oil County. What's the stat you pulled?
Well, Mark Cassie, with his two-year-old's first-time start, his maiden special weight on the turf, he's 22 for 156. I wanted to show overall stat of 14%, 41% in the money, but still has that positive return of investment in Oil Colony. As you mentioned, being the son of Bernardini, he's been working well on both turf and dirt up at Palm Meadows. I like that move. Gets Lasix and the apprentice.
Three pick fours on the card here on this Independence Day at Gulfstream as we start that middle pick four with race number five. Main tracking it here. Three and up filly mare, 6250 claimers. I prefer, and they're not layups in this race. It is a fairly competitive field, even when you add in the likes of the five, Nikki Bella, some of the other horses that have run consistently well for 6250. But I prefer the new claims, the new acquisitions, including your top pick, the one Tuesday's Rose, and wound up taking the number six, our Addie Bell, on top as she ships in from Kentucky for trader Peter Walder off the claim.
Yeah, a new face on the local scene, debuts for Peter as a five-time winner at the distance, a nine-time winner overall, facing 5,000s over there. But Edgar Zayas is going to jump aboard, but Tuesday Rose, who I put on top, moved to the Carlos David Bond after the claim, turns back to three quarters of a mile, posted his second consecutive victory at 6.5. Good form, good barn. I'm going to go right back with Tuesday's Rose.
And Carlos doing a good job, yeah, for sure. I mean, he worked for Jason Service for a number of years. Now out on his own, not an easy. Happened to bump into him on the apron the other day here, and he was saying, you know, it's an uphill battle being sort of a new trainer down here looking to pick up clients, but he's done a good job with the live bullets that he's had thus far, and he'll go from the inside with the one Tuesday's Rose. Here's race number six, middle portion of this 4th of July as we head back to the turf and back around two turns with this $10,000 three and up claimer. And I had a feeling, Ronnie, I hadn't looked at your picks before we came on the air, but I'll tell you, you're playing any multis, it is very hard in any sort of, you know, not trying to get overly cute or inventing things. It's really hard in this race going against certainly the one good old boy who's back on the turf, but even to a lesser but still major extent, the number five, Shidoshi, they just look like they're more talented. They have better form and just better races than everybody else.
Yeah, and I mean, that's the way I saw the race, too. And good old boy, he's going back to the turf. He followed that driving two-lifetime victory on the grass. Comes back, he ran great. He had that hard-fought second. That was that race move from the grass to the mile on the sealed sloppy track. You hear that an awful lot because we had that really wet June here. Mike Maker, Edgar Zayas, inside door. But Shidoshi had that big 4.5-length lead and just got caught at the wire. I think these are the logical two.
Yeah, Shidoshi, his last or two of his last three races going this distance around two turns, beating a neck and beaten ahead. He has run well, but he has, again, suffered some pretty tough beats. We'll see how he does. I happen to think good old boy is perhaps the better racehorse going this trip. But, again, they are hands down the big two in race six.
And if you play musical jockeys, Edgard's sticking with good old boy while Shidoshi's going to have Luca Panici today.
Yeah, Luca P. from Milan, Italy, in the mix this afternoon. He's live throughout the day, as are we, as we hope you stay tuned with us on this 4th of July edition of Gulfstream Today. Ronnie's Rainbow after this.
And they're off in the Princess Rudy with a quarter mile left to go. Four off the top of the turn. Race for the Kathleen O'Connell barn in front by five with just an eighth of a mile to go. And she's turning in this into a runaway. The powerhouse performance. She punches her ticket to the Breeders' Cup and wins by five.
Oh,
About 45 minutes out to the July 4th opener. We extend the racing here today, Ronnie. It is a holiday after all, and always a great tradition running, of course, a live racing program on Independence Day. We'll run 12. We begin at about 12:50, give or take, and that'll set us up for a holiday weekend. We hope you'll be out all weekend long joining us here at Gulfstream and a late start here tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah, we got the Twilight Racing each and every Friday till August 30th, and we have a band every Friday night, so it's a lot of fun. Come out to Gulfstream Park, and you got fireworks tonight. Just spend Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday here at Gulfstream Park.
Absolutely. And get a piece of the 12% takeout, $1 minimum Stronach 5, which is an East Coast Stronach 5 for sure. I mean, Santa Anita and Golden Gate are in their annual summer vacations, if you will. That leaves us Laurel Park and, of course, the racing action here at Gulfstream. And I kind of like the way off the bat this plays out, where you've got the late double up in Maryland and then right into our last pick three here tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah, we're going to see Hope Stan. Helps me out. Stan and I put the ticket together. I think we got a $72 ticket.
Yep.
We'll see how it plays out. We've hit it a couple of times.
Yep.
It hasn't been bad.
Pretty good of late, my friend. Let's hope for more of that tomorrow afternoon on that Friday, July 5th, as we, of course, backtrack and bring on another group of two-year-old maidens. There's a number of different juvenile maiden claimers on the card today. This will start the Rainbow Six.
Yeah, I used a couple of them in my Rainbow Six ticket. I used the 5 Cat K and the 6 Waikiki on my ticket. Went 3 deep in race number 7. Race number 8, I like that race with Baffin Bay, Grand Journey, and Timmy M. Race number 9, just used 2 in there, just the 7 to 10. We had a couple of scratches in there. And then the stake is part of this today, and I went with Salute the Colonel and Marshall Eddie on my ticket. My long shot today comes in race number 11. This is a hard race. I went with 1st and 3 for David Forks at 6 to 1.
That's a really solid field on the dirt. Excellent race. In fact, I like the 8th. The stake in the 11th very much. And then you've got to work your way through, again, some more lighter raced as a whole of two-year-old maiden fields in both the 7th and the 12th, the bookend legs in today's $12,000 Rainbow Six carryover. And again, keeping with that theme of guessing and maybe hoping in some respects, I'm going to give a chance here, despite a 20-length loss in a 5-horse field first time out, to the number 3, Kitty Jack. Few key changes today, the first of which trumps everything else, is the fact that first time Gilberto Zerpa off the trainer change. And for him to reach out for a Misael on this horse, I'm going to think going into this, he's very live for the 12-5 and is a legitimate wire-to-wire threat.
Yeah, that's a good angle there. I have him further down on the ticket. Like I said, I did use the horse you have in 2nd and 3rd on my Rainbow Six ticket, the 5 being Cat K, who's stretching out to 5.5 furlongs. He stalked the pace. He finished that promising 2nd. At this level, it's Oscar Gonzalez, Edgar Zayas, returning on the daughter of Brethren, Waikiki, another daughter of Brethren from Emmerdale. So they seem to have all the bases covered in here. So those are my 2 that I used on my Rainbow Six ticket.
Still remember Cat K running for the Phipps and for Shug. Not too long ago, maybe around the turn of the millennium, and Cat K, the Florida bred by Brethren, in the mix here, 2nd time out, as Ronnie said, 1 or 2 in the mix for sure for Arundel Farm. You've got Oscar with Cat K and Stanley Go with Waikiki. Race number 8 does start the late pick 5 on this July 4th, 2019. A very good field to start it out. I am 1-4 in this opening leg, using Baffin Bay and the 4-year-old, the number 4 Grand Journey. I trimmed the number 2 in this $18 ticket. Timmy M at the last 2nd. Singling in race 9, I just don't see really, Ronnie, any other options outside of the number 10, Miss Mario. And it's the kind of race, even if I did, I just don't want to double the ticket. I'm just going to put all my eggs in one basket. She will never find an easier condition to get it done this afternoon than in today's 9th race. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you know, that's the spot. Then we had a couple of scratches, as I mentioned. Mm-hmm. You could use the 7 a little bit maybe in there, but that's just for if you want to save. That's Rapid River.
Now, I'm not sure who will be favored. I think it'll be in this upcoming 8th race. It'll be very close between Baffin Bay on the rail, the 3-year-old Timmy M, who's been stake-faced, who you like, and the number 4 Grand Journey, who watched this ride last time out. We'll get right into this horse's last start on May 24th, and I pulled this replay after going back and watching it, of course, and just seeing how good Amisael Jaramillo rode this horse up close, got his position going forward, tracked in the pocket, and you watch just this smooth angle out there getting in between, just didn't lose any momentum, didn't panic, and he's just able to come right through here. And at this point, it's only a matter of time before Grand Journey's gonna take the lead, and just a question of how much will he win by. I'm looking at this horse who was cut out and bred to be okay. Maybe the light bulb finally went on. I feel as though, because as he faces the toughest field of his career thus far, he's in the best form of his life, and I'm hoping he's not a finished product, that we haven't seen his full come-out party yet.
And that was a great ride by MSCL, just splitting horses. Anytime you see that, and that was against those 35 optional claimers, and you saw that race. But I did go, as you mentioned, with Timmy M, who's heading back to the turf and facing allowance claiming competition. They followed his fourth place finish behind Val Me Now, who will be running on Saturday. That was in the 75 English Channel. Turned out to be a pretty good race. That, and then came back, poor showing, and that rained out Thirsty Fish, which was moved to 7 on the main track. I think faces older horses today with Jairo Rendon. I think this horse has a touch of class. And what about Hard Knocking Baffin Bay? You got to have that one on there.
Well, maybe Safi got away with one last time out. I mean, you know, you often hear the claiming game. I'd say a popular analogy is playing a hand of poker and who's bluffing and, you know, who's just playing the game the right way. And I was a little surprised nobody jumped in and maybe took this horse for 35. And again, there were no takers out of that win, and he's back for 75 G's.
And he's in for the 75 tag. So if you want him today, you got to pay a lot more money. You know, he would try to make it 2 in a row, and he could survive that stretch duel to defeat those 35 claimers, going 7.5. I like that horse. He always runs well.
All right, my single in the late pick 5, housed in race number 9, couple of defections from the inside post, and Alex Babe and Uncaptured Angel leaves us with a field of 8, and Miss Mariu on the outside as she drops for a barn that I like, and Amiseo. I mean, she's going to be a big favorite here.
I'll show you a stat on Victor Barboza. Turf to dirt in all claiming horses. He's 9 for 31, 29%, 65% of the money, and $1.95 is the return of investment. So good stats. I had this stat drawn before there was scratches, and this one sort of jumped off the page. As I mentioned, the only other one you can use is Rapid River, who's dropping to this level, turning back. Maybe that faded got beat a ton against those two lifetime claimers going a mile in the 16th on the sloppy track. So maybe this one wakes up today, but it's the race is through Miss Mariu.
Without a doubt. The one thing that scares me with Rapid River is she's got more speed than the favorite.
Right.
Not a race that takes all that imagination to perhaps come up with a scenario where somebody, including perhaps the 7 Rapid River, just gets brave. But again, Miss Mariu might just be the better racehorse. Here's the 10th, our 4th of July stakes race, as we bring on more of a starter allowance type stake, very much akin to those races we run on President's Day. And you do get some hard hits. And in fact, after scratches, we go with 7 around 3 turns at 1.5 miles in the R.H. Lee, a $60,000 starter stakes. And of course, we've got that big rematch where you've got the top 3 finishers, Ronnie, coming out of the home of the brave back on May 27th. Here's the race, and salute the Colonel, who had been pretty classy in context to these and certainly stake faced throughout the winter. He was able to reel in your long shot on the day, and Marshall Eddie, who you liked, and ran a great race.
He ran a great race that day and just got beat at the wire. Salute the Colonel. And of course, as Jason mentioned, this at this 12 furlong distance, one of my angles always the better horse that's a proven commodity at this distance. And certainly any one of these, you know, salute the Colonel, Marshall Eddie, even, you know, Whiskey and Roses. And the horse that you had on top, the 5 horse today, I kept going back to this horse, but I didn't use it. But a good performance here by Salute the Colonel.
Who ran great. It almost seemed like he was just emboldened and a little aggravated that Marshall Eddie just kept coming out and bumping him, and finally was able to put that horse away in deep stretch. And he's the horse to beat. The more I looked at that race, as good as it was for certainly Salute the Colonel and Marshall Eddie, and I guess Whiskey and Roses ran okay, even though he was a no-impact third. Why not take a different face out of there? And if you want somebody potentially to win today's R.H. Lee that didn't run in the home of the brave, most are probably going to land on the number 5 second mate, who's coming in out of a win. And I only mention that because he's not a dirt horse. I think that underscores the fact that he's just a good horse to begin with, and that gives me hope considering Mike Maker claimed this horse in late March for a good claiming price, certainly a lot of money, over $62,000, that he feels as though this horse maybe was meant for these marathon races over the summertime here on the Gulfstream turf.
No, I was just looking. He's the morning line favorite in there, so I you know,
it's
got
to be close between him and Salute the Colonel,
well,
right?
Two and five to two. I was just looking, and I went back, and I was handicapped, and I kept going back to that horse, and I ended up pushing him down because of the 12 furlongs. I would not be surprised if he wins.
No, Mike Maker certainly has made some good turf claims over the years and seems to have a knack in these longer 11 furlong to 12 furlong grass races. I'm hoping for more of the same there with that horse there in our featured 10th. Final dirt race on the card, a very good race. You're too deep here, right, in your Rainbow Six?
Yeah, but
you can't. I know you got your long shot here. I think it's a tough race, though, and it just underscores how difficult it is and how complex a puzzle. It's tough to be confident in anybody because it just, the more I work my way through, I'm going, well, this horse can win, this horse can win, and this horse can win.
Without a doubt. But when you're putting a ticket together and you want to keep it affordable so you don't go broke, I had to, you know, go somewhere. And I liked First and Three today as my long shot, so, and Gloria Florida. But, you know, there is, like you said, the horse you have on top, Polar Jet, the 9-5 morning line favorite in there. I wasn't that enamored with him, so I backed off him. But when I went and saw your pick, I said maybe I was a little too brave with my long shot today.
No, I mean, well, look, you're going to get paid if your horse does run well here from the outside in First and Three for David Fox. I was a little surprised at how short Jay had Polar Jet in this race. Clear-cut favorite. I did not like that horse's last race at all, even with the slow start. He was very sluggish out of the gate, and to me, that is a potentially bad sign going into a race, although he's technically dropping down. This race came up as tough, if not a little tougher, than that allowance race or optional claimer that he exits. The more I looked at the 6 squeeze adios for Terry Pompey, the more I got a little bit of a winking at the dude Alerstra vibe. Right. She's had a few horses that have had and shown some quality in the past. All of a sudden, the last month or so, really stepped forward, and kind of hoping that pattern works. Third time's the charm, perhaps, with the number 6 Squeezy Autos. We've also got a very tough horse here. In fact, an 11-time winner and a 6-year-old by First Dude by the name of Starship Apollo. And I thought we'd give him some props. And much like some of the others in here, he's going up in class and is in a pretty salty spot. The good news is, Ronnie, with this victory, even at a lower level claiming condition on May 30th, he was really able to put two pretty lackluster efforts off the claim for Kathleen O'Connell behind him, and I think he showed the life that we've, for the most part, been accustomed to seeing with the horse, again, who is about as tough as they make them.
And if he would win, I would not be shocked. I just thought with the jump up today, I'd have to see one, but he certainly can win another one in here. Mentioning my long shot in here, First and Three, a distant second behind a Grade 1 Florida Derby winner, Maximum Security. I mean, a really distant, that was a 50-starter option claimer. February, now going to face these 12-5 state-bred optional claimers. Ran against 35-starter optional types last time out. David Fords. I just think the son of First Dude is spotted perfectly against older horses today.
Yeah, he's one of a couple in there by First Dude. You've got a couple of Adios Charlies, including the 7 Ice Tea, as Mary Epler, who's been pretty quiet here over the last 3 months. She started just 9 here over a 90-day span at Gulfstream Park. She'll bring Ice Tea in from Maryland off a win, and in fact, she'll send out my top pick in race number 12 this afternoon, the 12th race finale, a 2-year-old filly, $35,000 maiden claimer on the turf at 5 furlongs, sees the 6 RC Smoke, who perhaps just needed a race first time out. Not a great effort at 4-5, I get that, but maybe she'll like the turf today over your top pick, the 8, Patty Heaney, who's the first starter at stud for Young Brian, who I had no idea who Young Brian was. I went back and looked. Ran once for trainer Phil D'Amato in the summer of 15 out at Del Mar. Won his debut with an 86 or 87 buy or 1/10 and never ran again. And this is his first starter.
Yeah, he's by hard spun, and Trina Nixon's 2-year-olds have been running lights out. Got Tyler Gaffleone in the saddle. Too much for me to like there. I'm going to go with him on top of my ticket.
All right, fair enough. Ronnie the first, or I'll take the second time starter, and we'll step aside here from our clubhouse studios for the one and only Pete Aiello. It's coming up next with those Thursday, 4th of July, scratches and changes.
The best chance for success begins with a solid foundation. At Hardacre Farm, early personal one-on-one care starts the journey to becoming a champion. Bred to leading stallions, our mares represent the highest standards. Hardacre Farm's signature in the breeding industry. Based in Ocala, Florida, breeder and owner Amy Tarrant has inspired excellence throughout her entire career. In your quest for success, start with Hardacre Farm. Breeding the champions of tomorrow.